Hi, welcome to another edition of Wednesdays at the Well. I am Minister Pierre Keys, the youth and young adult pastor at the great Third Baptist Church of Chicago. Hey, if you are really feeling this Wednesdays at the Well and you think that this can encourage someone, please hit the share button. If you want to be notified the next Wednesdays at the Well, hit that notification button because we're here every Wednesday at 7 p.m. Tonight, we're going to continue our annual theme of One Heart, what it means to walk for a community of believers to have one heart. And I want to build on this theme of having one focus. It's one thing for us to be in community together, but it means something else that we can have one singular focus on a God-given assignment. Amen. Why don't you go with me in prayer? Father, we thank you for another privilege to glean in your word. Lord, right now, send your spirit and illuminate the holy scriptures so it may edify the life of others, but also our own lives. Holy Spirit, fall fresh on us so that we can hear clearly from you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Have you ever seen a pigeon walk? It's quite an awkward locomotion. They thrust their head forward and they protrude it back. Then they take a step. They thrust their head forward again. They move it back and then they take another step. Do you get the picture of what I'm talking about? It's a weird type of locomotion that pigeons have. And the reason why pigeons are not strutting on the sidewalk or primping down the street, pigeons have a focus problem. They lack the ability to walk and focus at the same time. So the pigeon has chosen instinctively to look before it takes its step. It wants to ensure that there are no obstacles or obstructions in its way before it takes another step. So the pigeon looks before it leaps. I believe pigeons can testify to us that it would do us in our faith walk a grand favor if we looked before we stepped. Perhaps your life feels like pigeon progress, the awkward sense of moving forward in life. Maybe your life has not went as smooth and seamlessly as expected. Maybe you believe since it's not happening when you think it should happen and as smoothly as you think it should happen, that it must mean that God is not a part of this thing. Let me assure you that God has given us the power to focus before we take a step forward. God, in his divine sovereignty, has given us people to follow and a history to connect to so that we can be aided in seasons of transition that require a singular focus on the task ahead. If you have your Bibles, tablets, or phones, please turn with me to 2 Kings chapter 2. Verses 1 through 14. That's 2 Kings chapter 2, verses 1 through 14. I'll be reading out of the NRSV version. Scripture reads this way: Now, when the Lord was about to take Elijah up to heaven by a whirlwind, Elijah and Elisha were on their way to Gilgal. Elijah said to Elisha, "Stay here, for the Lord has sent me as far as Bethel." But Elisha said, "As the Lord lives, and as you yourself live, I would not leave you." So they went down to Bethel. The company of prophets who were in Bethel came out to Elisha and said to him, "Do you know that today the Lord would take your master away from you?" And he said, "Yes, I know. Keep silent." Elijah said to him, "Elisha, stay here, for the Lord has sent me to Jericho." But he said, "As the Lord lives, and as you yourself live, I will not leave you. So they came to Jericho. The company of prophets who were at Jericho drew near to Elisha and said to him, "Do you know that today the Lord will take your master away from you?" And he answered, "Yes, I know. Be silent." Then Elijah said to him, "Stay here, for the Lord has sent me to the Jordan." But he said, "As the Lord lives, and as you yourself live, I will not leave you." So the two of them went on. 50 men of the company of prophets also went and stood at some distance from them, as they both were standing by the Jordan. Then Elijah took his mantle and rolled it up and struck the water. The water was parted to the one side and to the other, and to the two of them crossed on dry ground. When they had crossed, Elijah said to Elisha, "Tell me what I may do for you before I am taken from you." Elisha said, "Please let me inherit a double share of your spirit." He responded, "You have asked a hard thing, yet if you see me as I am being taken from you, it will be granted you. If not, it will not." As they continued walking and talking, a chariot of fire and horses of fire separated the two of them. Elijah ascended in a whirlwind into heaven. Elisha kept watching and crying out, "Father, Father, the chariots of Israel and its horsemen." But when he could no longer see him, he grasped his own clothes and tore them into two pieces. I want to talk about tonight one focus, having one focus. I've read in your hearing what is happening in 2 Kings chapter 2, verses 1 through 14. They have an exiting prophet by the name of Elijah and an emerging prophet by the name of Elisha. This walk looks like pigeon progress. It's a unique way to move forward the prophetic office of Israel, because Elisha is much older than Elijah. How can God's people move forward when their spiritual leader is a lot older than their exiting leader? Aren't we supposed to grow older, younger as an institution? It looks like we're taking a step back. And God says, "I don't call you by age. I call you because I can." God says, "It's my call in the first place. I can use the older for a new thing, but I can also use the younger for the first thing." This is what God is telling us in this story. Age or tenure is not a prerequisite to do God's will. God can call someone in the latter stages of life to do something new, and he could confirm or affirm the completion of the younger by giving him the stamp of finished. You don't have to be past retirement age to hear the words, "Good and faithful servant, well done." And neither do you have to be fresh out of college with a degree in your hand to answer the Lord with, "Lord, here am I." Calling is not contingent on age, tenure, or experience. The contingency of the calling is simply on the one who's doing the calling. That is our Father God himself. And if you want to make sure steps rather than uncertain steps, you may want to thrust your head. You may not want to thrust your head forward and back like a pigeon, but thrust your head up and look up to God in prayer and ask for direction and permission before you take a step forward. You should look up to God before you take your first step. That's what the first lesson is tailored to teach us. Before you take a step forward, have a talk with God. Elisha does not allow his age to keep him from being used by God to do a new thing in his life. And Elijah does not allow his youthfulness to prohibit him from mentoring Elijah. They both had a disposition of humility so that they could both be a part of God's ultimate plan in the life of Israel. Pastor P, what does that have to do with focusing? Here it is. Elijah is about to die. There is nothing that Elijah can do for Elisha. There is no material gain Elisha can gain from Elijah. Elisha lacks the experience that Elijah has. All that Elisha has done to this point was focus on Elijah's life and ministry. And the prophetic office is not a glamorous job, because Elisha has been called to a position that requires him sometimes to deliver bad news to God's people, and also to a life in solitude to hear God's voice. So he's older. He has nothing materially to gain, and the call is not glamorous, nor is it lucrative. It's enough to make this transition feel awkward, but Elisha does not focus on his feelings. He focuses on his faithfulness. What does this mean? It means that arrogance and entitlement are enemies to development. Let me say that again. Arrogance and entitlement are enemies to development. I have to stop trying to use your feelings to dictate or discern God's voice in your life. I know that this is a unpopular job. I know that the call seems insurmountable. I know that you seem unqualified and equipped to answer the call, but remember who is doing the calling. You can allow your feelings to discern the call of God, and neither can you allow, watch this, the unpleasantness of the call to dictate your sense of effectiveness. Say it real plain, Keys. Just because it don't feel good doesn't mean that God has not called you to it. Just because, because I can hear you saying, well, the vibes is not right and it's not giving me the right energy. But come to me to the Garden of Gethsemane, where our Lord is wrestling with taking up his crowd. And he did not say he was not feeling the vibes of the Roman soldiers, or the energy of his disciples was lost or off. But he took up the old rugged cross because it was about faithfulness and not feelings. If I can move on to the second point, not only do we need to surround ourselves with people that are focused on God, not only do we have to discern God's call apart from our feelings, but Elijah is focused on his faithfulness to the call and not his feelings to the call. But another thing, you can also discern that God has given you people to help you focus on the call. When neither of you have anything to gain from the relationship, that's probably a good sign that it's a God-ordained partnership. I know social media tells you to only mess with people that are on your level. I know that your job and your social circles says that I only can socialize with people that I can benefit from. But the real test of a spiritual relationship is when you're in it and you don't have anything to gain. I'll argue that the true tests of partnerships that are meant to help you focus on the assignment are partnerships where neither of you have anything to gain. In fact, your gift can only truly be seen in relationships and assignments where you have nothing to gain. Your giftedness, the shine that God has given you, can only be magnified when you have nothing to gain. It reminds me of a time that we took my son Dallas out to lunch. And if you ever been out with a toddler out to lunch, while you wait on the food, that they can get antsy and they can get pretty active. So the best thing for a parent to do is to occupy the toddler's time before the food comes. So we gave him his iPad and he's making these drawings. And in these drawings, there's a drawing and it's of the daytime. Then he says it's a drawing of the evening and it's a drawing of the night. And he says, he gives me the iPad. He says, Dad, take a look at my drawings. And I am right swiping through the drawings, and there's a house and a tree in the daytime, the sun is out. And there is a house and the tree in the evening, and the sun is still out. And it's dark and it's night, and the sun is still out. And I said, son, why didn't you remove the sun from the painting at night? And he says, daddy, the sun is always shining. That is what God's message is for you tonight, is that no matter where you are, is to let your light shine. Let the giftedness in you shine no matter where you're at. Not only does God give us people to help keep us focused, but God wants us to remember our history so that we can remain on the task at hand. At every stop on this journey with Elisha and Elijah, Elijah is giving him a history lesson so that he can never forget his past. He's walking him through Gilgal, through Jericho, and to and through the Jordan. He's letting him know that he's going to be fulfilling his prophetic role in a time where there was rampant idolatry and rapid oppression. The poor are being exploited. The marginalized, they're being exploited and marginalized by the government. There was more concern about preserving their wealth than spreading the wealth and resources to the least of these. These cities that Elijah walks Elisha through, Gilgal, Jericho, and Jordan, are in the reverse order that God led Israel to while they were walking in the promised land. And Elijah wants Elisha to know that he will be outmanned, undersupplied, and under-resourced, but so were your ancestors, so were the people in the past. So I want to take you to the places where I have gave them the victory, where they were outmanned, under-resourced, and under-supplied. They defeated more sophisticated armies in this city before. They defeated nations filled with giants and more chariots before. And God is using Elijah to remind Elisha that if he forgets his past, he's bound to miss his destiny. This is a lesson of staying connected to your history, that when God calls you to something new, that if you're connected to the past, it should be a vision of what God can do in the future. This is why you can't throw your senior saints away. This is why you still need to sit up under grandmas and granddaddies and our aunts and uncles' tutelage, because they have a connection with the past that you and I don't. Yeah, you are educated and make more money, but grandma got more sense to you. I can prove it. She fed 14 kids with one chicken, and when there was little niblets of chicken left, she made chicken noodle soup. When the bread ran out and just the butts of the bread were left in the loaf, grandmama collected those, and from the leftover bread, she made bread pudding. When she fed you rice for 3 days straight and y'all got tired of rice, mama took the rice that y'all didn't want to eat and made rice pudding. And she worked jobs washing floors under degraded conditions. And here you are with the corner office and the doctor that got to give you pills for you to go to sleep at night. Grandmama knows who is her help and where her help comes from. You need to be connected to your future or you'll miss your destiny. I'm out of time. But you better check your history, because the same God that brought her out, the same God that did it for Elisha, the same God that did it for Elijah is able to do for us today. Story ends like this. Elijah says, hey, man, I'm about to die. I have nothing to give. Elijah says, man, I don't want nothing from you, but a double portion of your spirit. Now, this is not the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit, whenever God was sending his spirit in the Old Testament, it was always temporary. It would come, then it would leave. This is for Jesus, before Pentecost, where the Holy Spirit would reign on us forever. So he wants a double portion of Elijah's spirit. And this is what happens in Elijah's life. He does eight miracles. He does eight miracles. In Elisha's life, he ends with 15. So it looks like the promise that Elijah gives Elisha to give him a double portion of his spirit isn't about to happen until one day there was a processional, there was a ragtag Mardi Gras funeral of one of the sons of the prophets. And as they were dumping this body, I know it sounds graphic, as they were putting this body in the grave, they didn't know that they were putting that body in the grave of where Elisha's bones were eroding. They put a dead body on top of dead Elisha. But here's what happened. There was still so much life left in Elisha's dead bones that it brought the dead man back alive. That's all the time I have to give. You better stay connected to your past so you can move hope, so you can move forward in the future. I know it's not fun being with grandma and granddaddy. They are closer to the end of life than you, but there's power in your history, and there's people that God has put around you to keep you focused. That's all the time we have for tonight. I'm Minister Pierre Keys. Please like and share this. Wednesdays at the Well. And meet us here next time at the same time for the next edition of Wednesdays at the Well. Thank you and God bless.